Hello and welcome to this week's edition of the Sunday Sermon. This week, before we get into our message, I want to share with you another bit of Christmas music. And I know that for some of you, this year you're missing a chance to gather together with folks and sing Christmas carols. And some of you are missing out on some of the Christmas pageants and programs and things that were that are anticipated this time of year. And so hopefully we can connect a little bit by in this video that I want to play for you this morning. Hope you enjoyed that. Get the technical things down here. And Well, I know you're stuck with me, the technical director, right now, and but I hope that you got the message and weren't distracted by some of the things going on around the message at the time, because that's the hard thing right now for us, isn't it? This time of Christmas, to not miss the message and not get distracted by so many things going on around the message. The message is still the same. Jesus Christ came, God sent his son, that we could have life in him. And what a tremendous message. And all the chaos and craziness that is going on in our world and in our lives, that we would remember. We would remember the message has not changed. Don't be distracted by so many other things around us. And joy. The joy about Jesus, the shepherd's joy about Jesus is what we're going to focus on today. You know, a few years ago, there was a survey done asking people what character from the Advent account did they most identify with. And you might think about Mary or Joseph or the wise men, anybody for King Herod. but not surprisingly, the number one choice that came one by a big margin was the shepherds. The shepherds. You know, most of us are pretty familiar with the Christmas story, and maybe we've become so familiar that it almost seems like part fable or legend in our minds. Some have sentimentalized it so much that they skim along on a superficial level. They're counting down the remaining shopping days and stressing out about all of the things that they normally would do and need to do. And we get so caught up in all of those traditions and things that we miss the message. And so this morning, I hope that we can focus on the message. It's kind of like the little girl that misquoted John 3:16, and she said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only forgotten son." And I hope that this Christmas is not the only forgotten son, it's the only begotten son, that you remember, that is a focus for you this Christmas. Last week we looked at the angel's plea, the various encounters with men and women surrounding the birth of Christ. And, you know, I find it very interesting that God chose to send the birth announcement about his son to shepherds. Luke chapter 2 and verse 8 doesn't tell us too much about the shepherds. There's no adjectives and no big descriptions there. It just says, and there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby. There were shepherds abiding in the fields, right? It's all it says. There were guys out here at work. Doing their job. And you know, throughout history of Israel, shepherds had been a noble profession. If you go back into the Old Testament and you go through some of the patriarchs, Abel was the first to have the job, but the names of shepherds, people like Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, and of course David, and God calls himself a shepherd, right? And that we are sheep, his sheep. You know, but over time, the job of shepherd lost its luster, if you will. And by the time we come to the first century, AD, the time of the birth of Christ, by the time that we reach that point in history, the job of the shepherd had lost its luster. The shepherds made up the lowest class of people. They came in just ahead of the lepers, actually. In the Talmud, which is a collection of interpretations and insights from the rabbis, right? And in the Talmud, it says, no help is to be given to heathen or shepherds. And that tells you a little bit about how the shepherds were viewed at the time. At the coming of Christ. And in order to understand how unusual it was to have the angels appear to these lowly shepherds, let me give you just a couple other pieces of information about shepherds. they were considered ceremonially unclean, right? Because of the nature of their work, they were unable to attend any religious services. So they were separated from the synagogue by the Jews. They weren't allowed to be there because they were ceremonially unclean. They were isolated and forgotten. They had to move from area to area to make sure that their sheep had something to eat all the time. And so they would have to move from place to place to find the new grass and fresh water. So they never stayed in one place sometimes very long. Shepherds were treated with contempt or mistrust. They were suspected of stealing from others, and the testimony of a shepherd was not allowed in court because they were deemed to be unbelievable and unreliable. And then they were also shepherds were known to be brash and bold, living out in the fields away from society, made them kind of unappealing. They were kind of a rough group, really, is how they were viewed by most people. So that's a little bit about the shepherds. I want us to see just how unexpected it would be to have angels and God's messengers appear to shepherds of all people, everywhere that he could have addressed this and had the angels go to, he had them go to the shepherds. And so what an amazing thing here, really. And, you know, I'm not much in the know about British royalty. You'd have to ask my daughter about that. But I think that kind of helps paint the picture. Now, most of you remember this, but Princess Diana died 23 years ago. Now, her wedding was watched by over 750 million people worldwide. And everything in her life and all the members of the royal family were reported endlessly through the media. And I know in the last year or two, there's been some other, you know, big happenings in the royal family. And it's been all over the media. I haven't paid a lot of attention to it. But anyway, putting that in mind, putting some of those things in mind, can you imagine when Princess Diana had her children, Prince Harry and Prince William were born, instead of the media attention and the birth announcement and all the nobles around the world and all these people getting this information, what if when she had the baby, they sent a messenger down to a bunch of dock workers there and told them the news, and they were the only ones that knew. They were the first ones to know in the middle of the night as they're loading cargo, and somebody goes down from the hospital and says, "Hey, by the way, there's now a Prince Harry," you know, or whatever. God entrusted the greatest message ever sent from heaven to a bunch of smelly shepherds. And, you know, actually, though, that isn't unusual at all. God always, always works wonders for the forgotten, for the despised, for the lowly. From the beginning of his time on earth, Jesus came to those who were humble, who were the downtrodden and outcast. In Matthew chapter 9, verses 12 and 13, Jesus said, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick." And he finishes verse 13 by saying, "For I have not come to call the righteous, but to sinners." Now, Jesus reached out to sinners like the tax collector Zacchaeus and Levi, actually Matthew that recorded those words. He reached out to prostitutes and to the demon possessed and to the strangers and to the Samaritans and so many different groups that he reached out to the society did not hold in high esteem, really. He did his ministry. Christ did in his ministry what the Father did in a borrowed stable. When the lowly shepherds arrived to worship the newborn king there in that stable, he set a pattern right then. You know, Mary captured her song in Luke 1:52. She says, "He has brought down the rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble." Paul said it this way in 1 Corinthians 1, verses 26 to 29. Paul said, "Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things in this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him." Luke chapter 2 doesn't say, "Now there were in the same region some scribes keeping watch over their scrolls by night." The Lord comes to the lowly and the undeserving and the neglected and the marginalized to show his power. The shepherds help us to see God has a message for sinners, just like you and me. Everyone matters to God, and the only announcement of Christ's birth goes to this bunch of uneducated outcasts. God sends his messengers to these shepherds to declare the news of the birth of the Savior, of the Messiah. As we briefly look at the shepherd's response, we'll see some lessons we can apply to our lives so that we don't forget the Son, that we don't forget Jesus Christ this Christmas season. I want to read out of Luke chapter 2 and verses 8 to 20. It says, "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.' And suddenly a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angel praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests.' When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, 'Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about.' So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what they'd been told about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherd said to them. But Mary treasured all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told." So the first thing we see about these shepherds are that they were attentive. In verse 8, they were doing their job. They were living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. If you were a shepherd, you had to be committed to your career. You went where you had to go to take care of the sheep. And, you know, you didn't punch the time card and go home. There wasn't somebody else to watch them. The shepherds got the first shift and the second shift and the third shift. That, you know, all the way around the clock, it was their job. And so we see that they were faithful. They were attentive. They were doing their job. They were doing what they had been set to do. And so that's interesting that we would find that. And if you're familiar, a side note on shepherds, but oftentimes they would find, there would be pens built along the countryside that would have, you know, kind of a pen, but they didn't have gates. And they would take the sheep and send them into those, and sometimes these were parked, you know, they were maybe up against the side of a hillside, a rock, a cliff, or wherever. But it created a place that they could herd their sheep into at night. And then a shepherd would lay across the doorway. And across that opening that would keep them from going in or out, and at night keep them safe. And it reminds us of Christ saying that in John chapter 10, that he says, "I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture." And we have that picture of the good shepherd watching over his sheep. And one other side note, these are all extra freebies here today, but sometimes the sheep would come from different different places into one pen at night out on the hillside as shepherds from one group and another group would come together, and they would get them all into that pen and overnight. But they could call out to their sheep the next day as they left, and the sheep would recognize their voice and follow them. And so when Christ said, my sheep hear my voice, they know my, and they hear me call. It was that way, though. They knew the shepherd. Those sheep knew the shepherd, and in a way, in a personal way, that they recognized that voice. And so another picture was shepherds along the way that we find in Scripture. But you know, they were out doing their job, and Paul reminds us in his letters to the Colossians that whatever we do it all for the glory of God. Whatever we're called working, we're not working for human masters. We're working toward glorifying God in whatever job we have, whatever we're called to do. And so think about that. You know, you may be wondering, well, God doesn't even really, you know, I'm not doing anything life-saving in this world. I'm not doing any really critical job, a mundane thing, whatever the case is. God knows what you're doing. He knows where you're at. And you are of personal interest to Him. You are not insignificant to God with us. And we need to be reminded of that sometimes in this world. We seem unimportant with things going on, but God knows where we're at and what we're doing, and God will meet you wherever you are at. And remember that. You know, hey, if you smell like sheep, Jesus will come and clean you up. And if your sins are overwhelming and you're buried in them, Jesus will lift you up. And so remember that. You were created in the image of God, an original masterpiece, no one else like you. And that is the signature of the Creator inscribed on your soul. And remember that, that each of us is significant. You know, another thing we see about the shepherds, that they were in awe. The Lord appeared to them, and it says in verse 9 that we read, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were so afraid. They were terrified. God meets us wherever we are, but He will bring us to our knees. And that's what we also need to remember in that He'll meet us wherever we're at, but His glory, His power, His righteousness, will bring us to our knees. And then God's glory lights up the sky around these shepherds and causes them to shake in their sandals. You know, whenever we come face to face with God's holiness, we should shake in our sin. We should shake in our sinfulness. Peter had this response when Luke 8, it says, when Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." He knew that he was not worthy before Christ, and none of us are worthy before Christ, but Christ invites us to receive salvation in Him, and He is worthy. He is worthy to stand in our place of judgment. And so, you know, it makes me think, when was the last time you found yourself in awe? When did you marvel at the Messiah? Has it been a while since you hit your knees before Him? You know, another thing about the shepherds is it was accepted. The attentive shepherds were filled with awe, and now they accept the message of the good news of great joy. They accepted the message that was sent. The angel said, "Don't be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people." The angel calms them down and tells them that this is incredible news that I am delivering to you. We would have you know, we would have a lot of fear if Christmas never happened. We would have fear in our life if Christ had not come and given us the gift of salvation that we have in Him. And so we would have a lot of reasons to be afraid. But the shepherds come and say, "Here's the good news. You don't have to be afraid now." And so, you know, A joyless faith in Jesus is a contradiction of terms. It's like jumbo shrimp. What? That doesn't go together. We have a joyless faith in Jesus is a contradiction in terms. Remember that. We should have joy in that. When the angels came, they said the message is for when it says you, it's plural. That is a plural term for everyone. And it says bring for all people. And that's there. But also don't just get caught. Only is it the message for all people that would receive Christ and that good news that would come. But also it's for you. The good news is specifically for you. That Christ died for you. Christ came so that he could die. And he died to give us the life in him. And so that is a specific gift for each of us individually. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests, is what they said. And the shepherds, they looked at each other when they heard this message, and they said, oh, let's go to Bethlehem, let's go see. And they hurried off. They hurried and acted on that. That's the next thing. They didn't just accept and enjoy the message they received. They acted upon it. They hurried off, found Mary, Joseph, and the baby who was lying in the manger. And the word hurried off means they left in haste. Let's go. We got to go see this thing. And, you know, the Bible is clear that acceptance must lead to actions. James in James 2:17 says, in the same way, faith without works is dead, right? Faith by itself that's not accompanied by action is dead. We can hear the message. We can hear a message. Hey, here's this thing that's going on. Hey, but if we don't act on it, you know, there can be somebody that has $1 million at the end of your street, and he's sitting there holding a bag of money, and he's offering a bag of money not just to you but to anyone that will come by and pick it up. But if nobody goes, all right, great offer. It's a great offer. But if we don't receive it, if we don't receive Jesus Christ, Christ came and died on the cross to give us life in him. But if we don't receive that gift of salvation in Christ Jesus, right, we have to act on it. We have to act on the message that we're given. And so the shepherds, they heard the message and they said, let's get going. And they took off to Bethlehem and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby. You know, a baby born in a smelly stable would not have been a problem to these guys that smelled like sheep, right, already? And check out the irony in this birth. Unclean shepherds came to a smelly stable to see the holiest of holy lying in a bed of hay. Many commentators point out the possibility that these shepherds would have been taking care of sheep that were going to be sacrificed in a temple in Jerusalem. Now, think about that. That these guys that are watching over sheep that are going to be used for sacrifice in the temple are the first to go and bow before the Lamb of God. And what an incredible thing. You know, and these shepherds in this area around Jerusalem, they were out in fields the same fields that 1,000 years earlier David had watched over his father's sheep, and now in that same pasture that around that city of David, they see the son of David born in the city of David, in that manger. What an incredible, God put some things together in such an incredible way that hopefully we don't skim over them so quickly that we miss that. And so the shepherds saw that, all that they had seen, and they left and they shared. You know, they didn't pull up a bale of hay and sit down and make themselves comfortable and visit. They didn't hang around because they knew They knew the message. They had received that message. And you know, the message they shared had nothing to do with seeing the angels. It says that they went out and they declared all that they had been told about this child. Again, don't get distracted by all the stuff around the message of Christ. The message is about a Savior who came. And that is what we need to keep our focus on. You know, God may be putting some things in your heart right now, calling you to do some things. And you know, it's not enough to say, oh, I have faith. We are being called to do things in service to Christ. So whether it's to share and care for someone around us or whatever the case is, you know, I don't know. God speaks to each of us in different ways, brings different things to mind that He is calling us to be involved in. But it's not just enough to say that we feel good about something or that's a great idea. We have to act on things and go to what God is calling us to do. And then the shepherds left, and it says they adored Him. They went back. You know, they went back to their same jobs. They went back to their same boring job as shepherds, right? But they didn't go back as the same people. They weren't the same on the inside that they were when that day started. It had all changed. They returned to where they started and were attentive to their jobs, but they were not the same people. They had been changed. And you know, they didn't write a book or go on a book tour or start a new, you know, web page and do everything along the way. After Christmas, they went back to their same job, but they went back rejoicing, and they went back sharing with everyone that they came across all that they had seen and all that they knew about this child that was born. The shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told, is what verse 20 says. They didn't just wonder about what they saw. They worshiped who they saw. A clear evidence of conversion for someone is always adoration. It's always adoration when someone comes to Christ that When we say, come, let us adore Him, we should have adoration for Jesus Christ. We should worship Him. We should praise Him. And, you know, somebody once said that many of us worship our work at our play, and play at our worship. And it's all backwards. Don't be distracted by the things around us in life. Focus upon Christ and the gift. And focus our adoration upon Him. You know, do you want to take that role of the shepherds? Are you willing to take that role of the shepherd, or you just want to plant yourself like a tree or an unmoved rock and just be there? Are you listening? When God speaks, are you willing to act on that faith? Do you stand in awe before God? Yeah, those are the questions today. Be attentive to what God has called you to do. Be in awe of God's message to you, not to you specifically, and to God's message collectively that He sent to us in that manger. Accept the gift of the good news. Act upon what you know is true and adore Emmanuel, adore God with us. The gift of salvation came through baby, the greatest gift ever given. We must receive that gift. The shepherds had to personalize their response. You know, the salvation is offered collectively, but it's also specific. And I can't just be part of a group and receive salvation. I have to personally acknowledge Christ and personally receive salvation. It doesn't matter, you know, you're not born into a Christian family. You may be born into a family with Christians, but you're not a Christian until you receive Christ. You may have a great heritage in a church somewhere, but you don't become part of you become an heir of Christ until you receive him. Receive Jesus Christ today. Christmas is real history, documented in history, but it must become your story or it doesn't change your life. Luke chapter 2, verse 11. Let's change the words just a little bit. Today, that means right now, in the city of David, a Savior, one who forgives sins, has been born to you, you personally, all right? He is Christ, the long-awaited Messiah, the Lord, your Master, and your leader. Are you willing to put yourself in that verse like that today, that right now, that you receive that Savior, the one who came to forgive you of your sins, and accept him personally as that long-awaited Messiah, as Master and Lord in your life? I love that Corrie Ten Boom once said that if Jesus were born 1,000 times in Bethlehem and not in me, then I would still be lost. No matter how many Christmas pageants you've attended or read the Christmas story or done other things, if you haven't received Jesus Christ personally, it hasn't saved you. Christ wants to save you, and so he offers that gift to you. My challenge is that you receive it today. If you have questions about how to do that, then contact me. I'd love to reach out and visit with you about what it means to be a Christian. And if you're a Christian right now, I challenge you to think about the last time you found yourself in awe of the message of Jesus Christ, and that you acted upon your faith, and that you, in your life, you worship and praise, you adore that Christ child, that Savior that came so long ago. Pray that God will bless the message and His Spirit will work in your heart today. Have a great day.